were on the issue. Here, see for yourself.
Hi, what's your name?
Mitch.
Mitch, Steven, nice to meet you.
Good
Mitch.
To meet you, man.
I have no idea whether you're familiar or not with the segment that we do, but it's basically an opportunity to rationalize one's position. I'm pro-life, and all that that would encompass here, I guess you probably understand where I line up. If you disagree with me or think there's anything wrong with my position, you're more than welcome to change my mind.
I do think there's a lot wrong with your position. If you're going to try to tell more than half the world's population, more than half of America's population, that they are not allowed to decide to do with their bodies what they want to do, but a dead body, if they're not an organ donor, they're not going to get harvested for organ donation, then I think that's really messed up. And frankly, I think that women should have the option, legally and otherwise, to be able to get an abortion if they want to.
Okay, there are a few presumptions there. No, I would never tell 50% of America, as you put it, about half of America, what they can and can't do with their own bodies.
But that's exactly what the pro-life argument is. You're going to make abortions illegal, which then is going to force the women of America to either find a way to get an illegal abortion, which has its own host of problems, both medical, legal, etc.
As abortion does.
Safe abortion doesn't.
Sure it does.
What things are medically wrong with a medical abortion?
For the baby being killed.
Okay, I'm not talking about the baby.
Why not?
Because the simple fact of the matter is the baby is not an autonomous living being.
Really? How so?
Because it cannot fend for itself.
Okay, so would a 2-month-old baby not be an autonomous human being?
We're not talking about a 2-month-old baby, we're talking about a fetus.
Well, no, I'm using your definition. You said cannot fend for itself. So is fending for itself the standard of what constitutes a human being?
No.
Okay, so what constitutes a human being?
The fact that it is born.
Okay. So what makes the difference between a human being and not a human being is 7 inches about the birth canal?
Yeah.
Okay. So you would be okay with abortion all the way up to 9 months?
In certain circumstances, yeah.
Okay. What do you mean in certain circumstances?
If the birth would be fatal to either the mother or the fetus, then I do think that abortion should be legal.
Well, sure. Let's say if the birth would kill the mother. Mm-hmm. I don't know any major pro-life advocates who wouldn't agree with that.
Yeah, I've met quite a few, actually.
No, I have yet to meet one. So maybe you can give me your Rolodex. But I certainly would say if you're looking at the direct threat to the life of the mother, yes, I understand that.
Okay.
But let me say, it sounds to me like that doesn't really matter because you would support abortion regardless.
Yes.
Okay, so why bring it up?
Because people, especially in America, have the freedom to make choices. And right now, the pro-life argument is trying to infringe upon one of their choices. Mm-hmm. And
quick question for all the women. Can you all raise your hand real quick? No. Seriously, can I get all the women to raise your hands real quick and keep them raised? I don't care if it's one-on-one. Of all of those women that have their hands raised, which one of you would rather be forced to carry an unwanted pregnancy to term?
I would. I would.
I appreciate it. No, hold on a second. I appreciate it. I really do appreciate it. But I also want to continue with this. Thank you very much. I appreciate your passion. That's the danger of using mob rule as your moral compass. Sometimes you don't like how it turns out. And I could have actually told you that there are a significant amount of pro-life women here. A couple of things I want to clarify. I would never tell a woman what she can and can't do with her own body. That's not what I am doing.
Okay.
That's not what she is doing. And I would never force a woman to carry a child.
Okay.
Okay.
But that's exactly what the pro-life stance is.
No, it's not.
So what about the pro-life argument and pro-life laws and regulations and all that is going to allow women the choice?
Mm-hmm.
Because that's the whole basis of the pro-choice argument.
Right. Yeah, that's a false premise. What laws would allow the choice to kill another human being?
But it's not a human being.
Well, it is a human being. How do you define a human being? You said fend for itself. That's not a consistent
line. Yeah, and that 7 inches of birth canal, as you said.
Well, you said you didn't agree earlier.
No.
Fending for itself. So, in other words,
no.
Up until 9 months,
not,
seven.
It's not a living human being until it crosses that birth canal.
Okay. Why?
Why? Because it's still in the womb. It is still a fetus.
So, well, hold on a second. So we're talking about, right now, a 9-month-old baby. Let's say 8-month-old, right?
But it's not a baby until it's born.
It's not a baby until it's born. So the only difference right now, I'm using a 9-month, let's pick an 8-month-old, okay? 8 months inside the womb, 8 months outside of the womb.
Mm-hmm.
One is a life and one is not?
Yep.
Okay, so what determines human life is location?
If a woman has an 8-month-old fetus, versus an 8-month-old child, that is right. A huge difference.
Because one is inside the woman, one is outside. The
yes.
Only difference is, let's call it geographical location.
But it's not the same as geographical location.
Okay, it's a location inside a womb or outside a womb.
But you're oversimplifying it. You're oversimplifying.
I'm trying to understand, why is one a life and one is not?
Because the fetus itself is wholly and totally dependent upon the mother that it is attached to via umbilical cord.
Sure.
Right?
Wholly dependent, very much
wholly
just
dependent
like,
by,
just like an 8-month-old born mm-hmm. outside of the
yeah.
womb born.
However, the 8-month-old child, the infant at that point, that's the important distinction, fetus versus infant,
mm-hmm.
is...
It's your important distinction. I don't think it's a consistent one, but continue.
Is the fact that a fetus, which has not been born yet,
mm-hmm.
and an infant, which has been born...
Mm-hmm.
In my opinion, it shouldn't matter whether or not the mother wants to keep it or not. Whether it's...
But I guess I'm not following you. Why does that determine the value of human life? Is it because you don't believe...
I don't believe
it's a human being because you believe it's a part of the mother?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So you don't believe that is a separate human being. You believe it's effectively a part of the mother?
Yes. Because up until the point that it is outside of the mother, whether it's C-section, birth, whatever... Then at that point, it becomes its own living human being.
Okay, I'm trying to understand.
That is still dependent upon other people because it is an infant.
Okay, so I want
to
make sure.
But it doesn't necessarily need to be the mother, biological mother, that is still hooked up to the umbilical cord to fend.
So I want to make sure that I'm understanding your reasoning for why it is a baby outside versus inside the womb, even though it's the same age. You are saying that location, and that determines. Whether it's a human life, because, in fact, when it's inside the womb, it is not a separate human being, it is a part of the mother.
Yes.
Okay. I've not misrepresented you there, I understand you correctly.
Yeah.
Okay. So an eight-month-old baby inside of the mother.
An eight-month-old fetus.
Eight-month-old fetus. It's not a person inside the mother. Okay. How many feet does the mom have?
Sorry?
How many feet does the mother have?
Two.
Not four?
Not four.
How many fingers does she have?
10.
Not 20?
No. Infants are likened to...
It's a part of the mother.
Yeah.
It's a part of the mother. The mother would have 20 fingers, 20 toes, 4 arms, 4 legs.
Okay. So
if it's a boy, does the mother have a penis?
You're trying to detract from the fact that...
No, I'm trying to understand your position.
Hear me out. So, effectively... It is a parasitic relationship between a fetus and a woman.
Define parasite.
Parasite is a being that is wholly and totally dependent upon its host.
That's actually not the definition of a parasite.
Okay, so what's the definition of a parasite, Mr. Webster?
I appreciate the presumption. No, actually, because by your definition, a fully born child would be a parasite because they're entirely dependent on somebody. A good example of that, for example, with sharks, remoras aren't considered parasites, even though they are dependent upon the food that they would get from their larger predator. So the reason here is because it actually does so at the cost of its host. At the cost of the health care of the host. At the cost of the actual ability, often killing the host. That's what a parasite is. And parasites don't necessarily even have to be inside the body, by the way. They can be in.
I'm aware of that.
No medical literature would refer to a baby growing in a woman's body as a parasite. That's an opinion.
Okay.
So
that's my opinion.
It's your opinion. But it's also your opinion that it is a part of the woman's body, but that doesn't seem to... I understand how you sort of juxtapose that next to, but the woman only has 2 feet.
Yeah.
The woman only has 20. So what are those fingers on that baby? What's the penis? Who does it belong to?
It belongs to the fetus, which, like we just said, in my opinion,
does have body autonomy from the mother at this point. It is not a part of the mother.
No, it is a part of the mother. Because so the mother it is has a still penis. Attached to the mother.
Does the mother have a penis?
No, because the fetus is a parasite.
Because the fetus is a parasite?
Yes.
Okay. I'm just trying to follow your logic trail here, because before you said it was, in fact, a part of the mother.
It is.
That was what... It is. And you're saying it's a parasite.
It why can't it be both?
I suppose it could be both. Okay. So it's a parasitic part of the mother.
Yes.
So the penis belongs to a parasite, or the arms and the legs and the feet and the functioning brain and the central nervous system and the ability to understand and recognize its mother's voice belongs to a parasite fetus that is in the mother and is not a human life.
Yes.
And that is why we have the right to kill it.
Yes.
Okay. All the way up until birth.
Like I said before, if it is going to be a fatality to either the baby at that point, the infant, or the mother.
Yeah, well, again, we don't need to discuss that because you don't care anyway.
That's a very, very strong assumption to make.
Well, you said earlier that you would support abortion regardless, all right?
Yes.
Okay, so then why bring up whether it's a threat of the health to the mother?
Because no medical professional is going to make a late-term abortion unless it's going to be a fatality to either the mother or the fetus.
That's not true. It happens all the time.
Name one case where that's happened.
10 to 12,000 a year, 1.6%, 1.3 to 1.6% of about 1 million abortions each year. And as a matter of fact, you can go right now and watch a video that we taped in an abortion clinic on Tuesday where they performed an abortion on a 32-week-old baby, no questions asked.
Okay, and...
It happens all the time.
Okay.
So, do you disagree with that?
Yeah.
You do disagree with that?
Yeah.
Because, okay, well, there we find some common ground there.
Because you... No. I disagree with your stance on it. Because you don't know what that woman's life... You don't know that woman's life. You don't know that woman. You don't know what the circumstances are. You don't know anything about her. Do you?
Yeah, I do.
You know her personally?
I know exactly what her circumstances are because she told them to us. Yeah. She was a woman who had 2 children already, a 6- and a 9-year-old. Mm-hmm. And, the youngest of which was now being sent off to kindergarten, and she didn't want to go through the mommy phase again.
Okay.
She wanted time for herself.
Okay.
So she went in, and they provided a 32-week-old abortion, no questions asked. That happens, late-term abortions, 10 to 12,000 a year.
Okay.
So I just want to make sure, because you jump around as to what's permissible and what's not. My line of logic here is whether you like it or not, it is consistent, along with the lady there who responded to you. A unique new genetic code is created at conception.
Okay.
Right? Sounds like you're saying whether it's in, whether it's out, depending on how the mother feels about the baby, it's circumstantial.
It is.
Just not a logically consistent way to justify killing another life.
Okay. Well,
but in that situation, is abortion okay? The situation I just described for you, you can go watch it right now.
Yeah.
Well, then let's not go to the extreme examples to make a point. Because if I were to say, hey, rape, incest, let's allow abortions, and say, but on the other side of the coin, would you be okay with making it illegal to perform other abortions? You wouldn't say so. So why bring it up? You're bringing up an extreme example that you don't care about. You support abortion all the way up until birth, no matter what. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.